The heart is so mysterious, it doesn't operate with normal physics. It's like a match that learned how to light itself. Like, whoa. And then instead of it just burning down and having no more energy potential, it regrows itself and lights itself again.
I'd like to welcome to the show, Lee Holden. How you doing, Lee?
Hey, thanks for having me, Alex.
Thank you so much for coming on, man. I'm excited to talk to you, brother. I've been fascinated with Qigong for such a long time, and it is a very kind of mystical and kind of like an unknown practice and art form here in the West, not nearly as popular as, let's say, yoga or something along those lines.
Right.
And like I was telling you before we started, I dabbled in it when I was younger, and it scared the living hell out of me because some things happened to me physically that I tapped into some stuff with it, and I never went back to it. Not for any other reason. I just haven't. But I'm kind of really excited to talk to you about your path with it. So first question is, how did you start this path with Qigong? And I'm assuming that connects to your spiritual path as well.
Well, yeah, Alex, I think, you know, Qigong is not something as well known in the West as yoga, but I'm doing everything I can to change that because, man, this practice is so powerful. It's very accessible, and it has incredible health benefits. And, you know, I've just seen thousands of people use it for health, healing, wellness, you know, power up, clear stress. Well, we could just use it on a day-to-day basis. And, you know, my history is that I was a competitive athlete. I played soccer at UC Berkeley back in the early 90s. you know, I had an injury. I was jumping up in the air. Somebody took out my legs. I landed on my tailbone, just completely threw out my back. And, you know, being that I was 19, I really heard it at that moment in the game. And then I just said, you know what, I'm going to play through this. And
of course.
So the next morning I took one step out of bed and my leg buckled and I was just out. So team doctors, you're out for the season. I was in tremendous pain. I was, you know, about a week into this injury, I was hobbling around campus. I was feeling really depressed. I hadn't felt depressed before, but I was, you know, I was starting on the soccer team and man, I was just so excited about it. And now I was sidelined and hurt and hobbling around. I felt like I was 90 years old and, you know, got cortisone shots. It took painkillers that did nothing. It didn't touch it. And the painkillers gave me a stomach ache. So now I had back pain and a stomach ache. And I remembered I took martial arts as a kid. And I remember this martial arts teacher of mine, he broke this big stack of bricks, just boom, and all the bricks shattered. And I was like 10 years old, you know, mouth dropped, like, how did you do that? And he said, it was the power of Qi. And then he took me by the lapel of my gi and he looked at me in the eyes and he said, Qi is for healing. It's not for hurting people. So I said, oh, I remember that guy. I'm going to go back. He said it was for healing. I'm going back to this guy and see if he can do anything about my back pain. So I went home. He gave me some acupuncture. He showed me a few, you know, the time strange exercises for the back. And, you know, in 1 week, I was like 70, 80% better. After three or four treatments, doing those exercises on a daily basis, in 2 weeks, I was back playing. I was, you know, 95% better. I was doing these Qigong exercises and I was like, why aren't more people doing this? It just was like feeling so good. Not only did my back pain feel better, but these exercises gave me this incredible feeling of energy. And so that injury, you know, at the time was the worst thing that happened to me. And then it became a catalyst to change my whole life because when I graduated from college, I immediately went to Asia and started studying Qigong. And I studied in Thailand. I studied in China. I made between 22 and 25. I did about 12 trips to Asia. In fact, I got a job as a ghostwriter for a really well-known Qigong master who had a beautiful retreat center in northern Thailand. And I became kind of his one-on-one go-to guy. And I'd go to his house in the mornings and we'd do all kinds of crazy exercises and meditations and energy practices. And I'd write them up and organize them into his books. And it just gave me such a hands-on, one-on-one with a master kind of experience. And when I came home, I was always like, okay, now how do I explain these to my soccer player friends that are now working in Silicon Valley, getting all stressed out? And that was just the beginning of this journey for me.
Now, can you explain to people what is Qigong?
Absolutely. No, so Qi just means energy. Gong means to work with. So it's energy work is basic translation. Gong also means expertise. So you develop an expertise at working with energy. Now, what is energy? Well, it's everything, because it's, you know, if we think about who we are energy. We have this body, we have a mind, we have emotions. Everything within us is categorized as some quality of energy. So the physical body would be the most dense form of energy. Think of it like ice, water, and steam, right? All of those things are H2O. They're all the same energy, just manifesting in different forms. So body, emotions, mind, spirit, it's just all one energy manifesting in different forms. That's why your emotions have such a big impact on your body. That's why the mind influences the body. That's why the body influences the mind. The energy transforms back and forth. So, you know, a bout of stress or depression, it wreaks havoc on our immune system. And we all know this, you know, stress is one of the most detrimental things that happens to us physically. And so how do we, you know, quite simply in Qigong practice, they just say, how do we transform stress into vitality? How do we gather more energy? I think everybody intuitively knows. If I said, you know, how's your energy? People are like, oh, well, I'm a little stressed out, or I feel a little tired. We all have this kind of sense of what energy is. But in Chinese medicine and a lot of the Eastern philosophies, they talk about it very directly and how to improve upon it and what kinds of things, you know, whether you're talking about yoga and the prana, that means energy, or Qigong and Qi. These things are working with the body's internal energy. And, you know, it was part of the medicine. There's five branches in Chinese medicine. And I think people know about these different branches. You have acupuncture, you have herbal medicine, you have massage therapy, nutrition, and the fifth branch is Qigong. And if the way the medicine worked is brilliant, because it was true healthcare. You use these five branches of Chinese medicine as prevention. Now you go to your doctor and you say, I'm feeling great. I'm going to pay you. You pay the doctor while you're feeling good. And they gauge your energy. They give you some acupuncture. They take these herbs. Make sure you do these exercises. And as long as you're feeling good and healthy, you continue to pay. As soon as you get sick, you stop paying. So the
doctor. Can you imagine?
Could you imagine? Isn't that hey, doctor, I'm not feeling good. I'm not paying you. You're not doing your job, because it's healthcare. You know, right now we have sick care. We don't have healthcare. So everything is based on, we need people to get sick in order for this medical business to work. So we do have incredible technology, but we do have also more sickness than ever before. So what this helps us to do, us individually, is say, you know what, I'm going to take charge of my own health and wellness. I'm going to prevent problems from arising before they even happen. And how does that happen? Well, we take care of our, you know, we eat healthy, we exercise, we move our bodies, but this became part of the medicine. So it's very highly tuned to how to keep yourself extremely healthy and how to overcome health challenges from a natural perspective. Because let's face it, in the Western medicine, it's really frustrating, because not only do you take a long time to go to see your doctor, they give you some medication. Those medications have side effects that sometimes work.
Yep. Go ahead.
This medicine is just keeping you healthy and powered up by looking at the root cause of any imbalance. So this is the reason I love this medicine. It's what modern life is calling for right now. It's like, how do I keep myself charged up and stress-free? If you want to think about Qigong in a really simple term, it's less stress and more energy.
So
who doesn't want that?
Exactly. So let me ask you an ignorant question, because I know a lot of people are thinking about this. There's a little bit more well-known art form called Tai Chi. So
yes.
And it is a form of energy work, but can you explain the difference between Tai Chi and Qigong?
Absolutely. You know, and that's a great question, because people do know what Tai Chi is. And Tai Chi is a form of Qigong. You know, first there was Qigong practices, all these energetic cultivation. Tai Chi was the martial arts practice of Qigong. And so Qigong is more accessible. In Tai Chi, there's every movement has martial arts application. Mainly people use Tai Chi now for health and energy cultivation, the same as they would for Qigong. Qigong is simpler because you don't have to learn a whole set of movements. In Tai Chi, one movement leads to another movement leads to another movement.
Right.
In Qigong, a lot of times the movements repeat themselves, so it's much easier to get into the practice and get the benefits right away.
Okay, so when we're talking about energy work and your energy in general, where, so many questions. The battery that we run on, we all have a battery of some sort. So there's always a different energy level. Certain people have higher energy levels. Some people have lower. That's determined based on diet, depends on environment, depends on stress, all that kind of stuff. What can we do on a daily basis to just kind of release the negative energy, the things that are bringing us down, and cultivate the things that are actually bringing us beneficial energies to make our day run a little bit smoother?
Yeah, and isn't that the million-dollar question? Because, you know, when we have good energy, it is, and when we have strong, high levels of energy, when we have health, I mean, that is true abundance. I mean, that is what we really should value, because it's not until we get sick or we don't feel good that we just like, I would just give anything for high quality energy and health and wellness. When we can get ourselves out of pain, I mean, this is so valuable. And the ancient masters of this art form really saw that. So, you know, what can we do? I mean, this is the answer to that question is Qigong. And here's why, because it's going to work on your breathing. So one thing that you can do, if we think about energy, where do we get energy from? Well, like you were saying, Alex, it's diet related, but we can go, you know, weeks without eating food and still be alive. But we can only go minutes without breath. And so your breath is going to be your quickest source of energy. And so when you do Qigong practice, a lot of work with the breathing and synchronizing breath with movements. And that's what gives us the energy. It's that skill at working with breathing plus movements plus how do we release tension in our bodies. You know, for example, everybody, while you're listening, we are all holding too much tension, right? Right now, if you just relax your shoulders a little bit, I just relaxed a little bit and my neck and shoulders came down, maybe just notice your upper back and neck. That chronic way in which we tighten our muscles, and which I'm lifting my shoulders right now, where we're holding tension over some hours, drains our energy. And so with the practice of Qigong, you're going to really learn where you're holding tension and how to relax into it, because it's unnecessary. Just because you're contracting your neck and shoulder doesn't mean you're keeping your head on. Do you know what I mean? Like if you relax your shoulders, your head's not going to fall off. So relax. We unconsciously tighten all kinds of areas in our bodies, our bellies, our neck, shoulders, our jaw, as a way to manage stress. We want to be in control of what we're not in control of. So when we see stress around us, or we hear, you know, pandemic this, we just start to tighten up our bodies because we want to have some control, even though we're not in control. So when you relax your breathing, what you'll find is that you'll breathe deeper. So just to sense, if I'm under stress, notice how you're breathing. Your breath should be slow. It should be through the nose, and it should be down into your belly and ribs. And so when you, for about 4 or 5 seconds, and exhale 4 or 5 seconds, automatically that kind of breathing for just a couple minutes is both going to relax you and energize you. And then what we do is we kind of take it from there. We work with breathing. We're going to stretch out your body. So Qigong is a little bit like yoga, but it's also like Tai Chi. It's kind of a combination. It's like a simple form of yoga plus flowing movements in Tai Chi. So it's going to get a wide variety of movements and exercises and stretches and kind of mindfulness flowing type of movements that get you into a really beautiful state of internal balance.
Now, there's there's an experiment that I heard about, the Stanford Experiment. Is that something you could talk about a little bit? Was there a Stanford Experiment regarding Qigong?
I think it was on Qigong and Tai Chi.
Okay.
And it was a wonderful experiment. They just found all kinds of incredible things. Like, for example, they took different groups. I'm not sure if it was this exact experiment, but this one was either done at Harvard or Stanford. And they wanted to see for seniors, what exercises prevented falls and had the best efficacy. And so they did a physical therapy group, they did an exercise group, and they did a group that didn't do anything. And then they did a Qigong group, Tai Chi and Qigong group. And far and above, the Tai Chi and Qigong group had the best prevention of falls in seniors, the best balancing kind of exercise, which is huge because, you know, for seniors, falls are one of the biggest risk factors, because as soon as the seniors fall, break a bone, hit a hip, then they're in the hospital. And then there's a lot of problems that arise from just going to the hospital, pneumonias and catching whatever disease there is at the hospital, or being sedentary all of a sudden causes a whole array of other problems. So that was great. There was also just the incredible way in which this practice is so accessible. It doesn't seem like you're doing a whole heck of a lot, and you're getting a lot stronger. Your body's in alignment. Your stress is being released, which is preventative. Do you know, Alex, the number one cause of 90% of our illnesses? That means 90% of the reasons why we go to our primary care doctor. I got a headache. I got digestive issues. That primary care first visit is 90% of it is stress related. So as you manage your stress, you are preventing 90% of the problems that might arise. So how do we manage our stress? Well, you know, there's all kinds of ways that we do, you know, and they're not very skillful, right? That, remember that gong means to work with, it also means skill. So we manage our stress. We have a cocktail at night. We watch TV. We just try to unwind. But if you're active about managing your stress, like you're breathing, you're moving your body in gentle way, you're stretching, it's much more effective in managing our stress than just passive relaxation. Active relaxation is the best.
Can you talk a little bit about the breath and breath work? Because it is something that people really don't understand the power of. I mean, I've done the Wim Hof method of breathing, and I was amazed at what I was able to do just by breathing and what I was, my body was starting to be able to take in. And, you know, like I was telling you before we started, I've been meditating for years and my stress levels drop, and I, you know, purely because of my slow breathing, everything kind of relaxes, things like that. But the breath work is so powerful. And if you do certain breath work, it affects you in ways that it's so difficult for people to understand. So can you dive in a little bit into the breath and the power of breath work?
When we're doing breath work, you are kind of in the operating system of your subconscious mind, because, you know, it's one thing I can tell you to do that your body's functioning, right? Your body's has this autonomic function, you're breathing, your heart's beating, right? But I can say, slow your breathing down, and you can slow down your breathing. There's only two things we can do consciously. One is blink our eyes, and the other is change our breathing. You know, I can't say, hey, digest your breakfast a little faster. Hey, slow down your heartbeat, now speed it up. Make your right hand warm and your left hand cold. We can't control all these physiological functions, but we can control our breathing. That gets us into the operating system of the subconscious mind. And once we're in that operating system, we can slow down the breathing, we can speed up the breathing, and then we can shift the energy that's circulating and flowing in your body. So it's kind of like, again, getting into the operating room of the whole system. And the way in which we breathe is a reflection of how we're feeling. If you look at any emotion, it is connected to a breathing pattern. So how does somebody breathe when they're angry? Well, it's a lot of strong exhales, huffing and puffing, right? Any of you guys know, if you have teenagers, you're going to hear a lot of sighing when you tell them to do something. They're just Why do we do that? Well, anger is a resistance to inhaling, Why? Because we don't want to take in somebody's perspective. We already know what we want. We feel righteous in our perspective and we exhale strongly. So then we look at sadness and it's a reverse of that. It's a resistance to the exhale. Why? Well, we're sad, so we don't want to let go of something. We don't want to, you know, let go of that relationship or that change that's making us sad, or we don't want to let go of that person or whatever it is. We hold on to it. And then, of course, we have to exhale, so we cry, you know, and that's the process of transforming emotional energy. So breath is a reflection of how we feel. Now, if we reverse engineer that, if we hack that, we can change our breathing to give a message to our emotional energy, how we should feel. So slow, deep breathing is going to say, oh, the nervous system would say, oh, okay, I must be relaxed. I must be calm. I must be at peace. So slow breathing is going to send a message to your system. I mean, laughing is a breathing exercise. It says we're happy, right? Think of somebody, what's happening when we're laughing? It's actually an expression of our breath. So it's very important. It's very tied together with the nature of our mind, our emotions, and every system in your body needs breath. And so we want to become oxygen efficient for our health. So slow breathing helps our nervous system go from fight or flight or sympathetic into parasympathetic, which is the rest and digest mode. And when we're in parasympathetic, then we're relaxed. And when we're in sympathetic, then we're stressed out. So the breath is the switch that will take us out of stress mode and into relaxation mode. And that's why it is so crucial. Because if we're chronically overstressed, again, that leads to health issues, major health issues, cardiovascular, immune system going, poor function in the immune system, digestive issues, because chronic stress really brings our body into low vitality. And, and relaxation helps us to find our balance.
So when you're afraid, I always use the tiger. If the tiger's in the room with you, your breathing is going to be pretty quick.
Mouth breathing.
Heart's going to raise and everything's going to be building up to fight or flight scenario.
Yes, correct.
Unfortunately, a lot of us live in that state constantly throughout our day. And that could be traffic. It could be our boss. It could be our spouse. It could be money issues. It could be, there's many tigers in our jungle.
Yes, that's right. And you know that it's an amazing thing about our mind, because the tiger isn't, if the tiger's in the room, it's great to go into fight or flight, but the tiger's in our mind. And the tiger, you know, you're just carrying the tiger with you in your mind. So you're always stressed out because there's no tiger in this room, but maybe tomorrow the tiger will show up. Right. Maybe in a week from now, the tiger, maybe the stock market's going to go down. Maybe the pandemic's going to come back. So we always have this tiger in our minds. So even though everything's fine right now, there shouldn't be a stress response. We create it by thinking about the future and worrying about it. Then we bring the tiger into the room. Now we're stressed out over something that's not here. So it's this way in which we scan for danger all the time.
But and also, I think when you're doing breath work, you are forced to live in the moment. Mm-hmm. Whereas, like you were just saying, we spend most of our day living in the past, which is our memories, or living in the future, which is our imagination, and not living in the present moment. And when you breathe, you are forced to literally be in the moment that you're breathing. You're focusing your energies on it. So that's another powerful thing when you're breathing. And when you're doing Qigong as well, you are absolutely in the moment. You're not thinking about the tiger down the street or in a day or two.
Yeah, exactly. And then when we come back to the moment, we neutralize the tiger. We make friends with it because there's no tiger in the room right now. There's no stress. So remember, stress is survival. If your life is being threatened, it is a great response, right? If you're facing a tiger, you know, once I faced a grizzly bear, I was in Alaska fishing with my dad, came face to face with a grizzly bear 3 feet away. I felt my stress response. My heart was racing. I was ready to run.
Qigong? You didn't do the Qigong at that moment?
I was 13 at that time.
Oh, okay. Hold on a second. I need to start breathing calmly now. That's not the time to start breathing calmly.
Hey, you know, there in Qigong, there's a whole sequence called the bear frolics. So whenever I do the bear frolics, I remember face to face with this grizzly bear. And it was a beautiful moment because, you know, the bear, grizzly bear could have had me as an appetizer, but he decided that the salmon was going to be tastier. You know, and that's, you know, that's when you're walking down a dark alley, you hear some noises, you know, there's somebody invades our house. So, you know, those rare moments we want to be in fight or flight. Otherwise, it's an overreaction. We are hardwired for survival, happiness, all the things you want are secondary to survival. And so you have to turn down that survival mode, especially in modern life. We don't live in the jungle. We're not feuding tribes. People aren't invading our house all the time. We don't need to be constantly hijacked by our survival mode. So that's why you need these techniques. You know, I don't teach any workshops on how to worry more, how to get stressed out. We got that hardwired into us. So we need, if you want to be happy, if you want to be healthy, you have to train it, because you have to override this hardwiring for survival, which is great. But modern life, we're living really well in modern life. Most of us aren't fighting in a war. Most of us aren't having to deal with actual survival. We just need to manage our survival so that we can be happier, because happy is less, it has less of a priority. So that's why when you're perfectly content in the moment, your mind goes, yeah, but what about tomorrow? Because we're scanning for danger in some future scenario. So we got to calm that down, because if we're in survival mode, we're not feeling peace or happiness. That's why it's so important, because if we're going, hey, I go into work, now I'm stressed out about traffic, I'm a little bit late, now I got to talk to my boss. Now, when I get home from work, now my spouse says something I didn't like. So we're constantly survival mode, stressed out. And then over time, that really wears on our physical health and our immune system. And in fact, people that are stressed and depressed, your immune system functions 30% below normal. And people that fall in love, their immune system is 30% above normal. So it's interesting. When you want to boost your immune system, and people are talking about that a lot these days because of the pandemic, you want your immune system to be strong, get out of stress, and start feeling good. That's one way to just boost the energy in your immune system. The other way is move your body. The third way, breathe better. So just get out of stress, move your body in simple ways, and breathe better. Your immune system is going to be way higher than if you didn't do those things.
And a lot of people don't realize that we're all pre-wired with negative bias. I mean, it is a it's a survival. It's why we're here. I mean, we had to constantly be scanning for the worst things possible in order to survive. And it's something that's been with us since the beginning. And again, because we are in a different world now, it's hard to turn that off. So I think being aware of it is step one. And then to try to address, but it is a battle, because it's literally, we're, like you say, you don't teach courses on how to worry more, because we're pre-wired. Every human being is. It's something that you have to kind of unprogram, rewire within yourself, look at things differently. I always love, talking to people sometimes, or I'm sure you know people like this who are positive all the time. They're just the sweetest, nicest, optimistic all the time. And then you always see a friend next to him like, why is Bob always so damn happy? How dare he be happy all the time?
Yeah, what? Hey, Bob's exasperatingly happy.
Like it's off-putting, really. You need to be a little bit more depressed.
Yeah. You know, modern life's complex, and we're complex creatures. And, you know, one thing we do want to be is real. You know, how are we feeling? We want to be real in the moment. Like, hey, man, I'm having a hard day. I'm feeling depressed. I'm feeling down. That's absolutely fine. It's the realness that helps us to get clear on where we are, because, you know, it's kind of like a map. If you're not real, you don't know where you're starting from. You know, when you go to a map, you're like, God, where are we? How do I get to where I want to go? It's like, when you look at that map and it says you are here, that's an important moment, because now I go, okay, from here, I want to go there. And so that just getting real with where we're at is like, okay, I'm here. I'm stressed out. I got this issue, I got that issue, but where do I want to be? Now, most people don't say, I want more stress. I want to be more depressed. The problem with modern life is it's not, even though we have all this great technology, you know, our cell phones don't get us out of stress and depression. In fact, they often create more of it. And so we are here. Here's where I'm at. I want to get to, you know, I want to get to abundant health, lots of energy, more joy, and fulfillment. Well, the map that modern life is giving us is not leading people there. When you look at modern life, people are not happy. People are not stress-free. In fact, we're not, as overall, it's not a pretty picture. And so we need to take charge of our own health and happiness. Like, hey, I'm right here, right now. I'll get clear about that. Where do we want to be? Now, step by step, what is the process that's going to get you there? You know, the journey of 1,000 miles starts with a single step, but it better be in the right direction, right? Otherwise, we're 1,000 miles off. After 30, 40 years, you're like, wait a second. I did not want to be here. You know, the way in which society is set up is not leading to really thriving individuals or a thriving society in terms of health and happiness. And so let's take on some new tools so that we can start to take charge of where we want to end up, both within our inside of ourselves, my mental, emotional state of mind and body, my health, and where do I want to be in my life, my level of fulfillment. And that's what this practice can really help us get clear on. Get clear on where we are, get back to the moment, get back into where we're at. So now transform the energy of the moment, build your energy up so you actually have fuel in the tank to get you to where you want to go.
Now, So let's say someone is about to start a Qigong practice. What can they expect to happen to them after the first few sessions, after a few first few practices? What are the physical benefits are going to be, the things that they can really feel right away? Nothing esoteric, but just in general.
Right. I mean, I think you feel after first class, a lot of people feel this melting away of stress and tension. This feeling of what? I didn't know I was carrying that much tension. You know, I taught a class. Weight Watchers hired me for about 2 years to teach and redesign all their movement. It was off the scale. We did this whole beautiful thing that we did. I traveled all over the country, lots of Weight Watchers centers. I trained Weight Watchers leaders to lead their people through Qigong practices. We did a tour of the UK. So it was about a 2 year journey of teaching to these. This company and a lot of their members. And I remember after one class, this woman was arms folded, brow furrowed. She was clearly upset after class. And I said, is something wrong? Are you okay? She said, no, I'm really angry. And I said, what is it? She said, well, I don't have pain in my neck and shoulder anymore. I've had this pain for 15 years. Why didn't anybody show me this earlier? Why haven't I learned this early? She's really mad. Yeah, my pain's gone. I'm really mad about
it. I'm pissed off. Why hasn't someone told me about this earlier? Why
is it? And I was like, I hear you. You know, I'm trying my best. But, you know, if we want to get out of pain, we want to get out. There's some very simple things that we can do. And, you know, that's the thing. It's like, why haven't we learned this earlier? Because, you know, it's just not something with the way society's set up, we don't want empowered individual. We want individuals that need things. I need substances. I need that pill. Stuff. I need this thing. I need stuff. I need stuff to feel good. And that's, you know, if you don't need stuff to feel good, our economy, our capitalistic way of being, which I'm not knocking, I'm just saying we also got to take charge of our own health and healing, because it's not going to be out there. It's going to be in here, our internal, we all your team, but first take charge of your own health and healing. You'll find that most things can be prevented, and most things can be overcome with the right quality of internal energy.
Now, is this a true statement that there are more people practicing Qigong than there are practicing yoga in the world on a daily basis?
There are more people practicing Qigong than any other form of exercise, partially because there are so many people in China and, you know, to be fair, they all, you know, there's a lot of people practicing Qigong in Asia and, It is, and it's 4,000 years old. I mean, this practice has stood the test of time, and it works. We just don't know it very well in the U.S. and modern world, because it's we kind of think of it as for the older people that go out into the park and do these funny exercises. Well, there's 3,000 styles of Qigong. So when you look at the different practices, there is some practices that are really well suited for you and whatever issues you have. So what I've done is I've researched this practice and I've said, you know what? For low back pain, here's the Qigong practice to do. For upper back and neck pain, here's the practice to do. If you have high blood pressure, do this practice. If you have digestive issues, try these practices. So I've created routines that are very condition specific, and they work so well. So I'm really trying to help people, you know, my shows that were on public television. What we did is we created these condition specific routines and people started trying them and it worked extremely well. You know, even though Qigong isn't well known here in America, those shows on Qigong that I did, they reached 50 million households. It was really well received. You know, a lot of stations were airing it because people were like, I tried those practices and it worked. And so it's starting to gain momentum. And I think Qigong is where yoga was 25 years ago. It's just going to start to get more momentum because it really is effective and it's easy to do. It's really accessible. You don't have to wear your spandex, get a yoga mat out, you know, get weights, you know, it's all body conditioning. It's your body working with itself and it's simple and easy. And that's why it's so accessible to everybody. And once you feel energy, and I think this comes back to your question, Alex, you know, what do you feel like when you finish a class? Well, you feel this tingling, you feel this buzz, you feel this electricity because you are energy. It doesn't matter if we look at it from a Western perspective, you know, ask a scientist how much energy you have in a body. You have a ton. Each cell in your body has a microcurrent, you know, 0.2 megahertz or something like that. And if you add up 50 trillion cells, that's about a bolt of lightning. That's what's inside of you. So every, you know, think about your heart. How does your heart beat? Well, electrical cells create that pulse. Now, if we look at science, why does your heart beat? That's a head scratcher. How did your heart start beating? Nobody knows. You are a mystery, right? So every cell in your body needs electricity. We're talking about the heart. The heart beats because of its electrical cells, electricity. The reason why you can close your eyes and see images, there's no light source there. That's a mystery. How do you close your eyes? How do you close your eyes? And how do you hear internal dialogue? There's no speakers in your brain. But these things are mysterious to both East and West. So they called it Qi. They called it heart Qi, liver Qi. If you look at any one aspect of your body, whether it's your eyes, your heart, your liver, at some point we run into the mystery. We say, I don't know how it works. The scientist doesn't know. I don't know how this brain works. We know that it does work. So the East said, well, there's energy. There's mysterious life force energy in there. Even though we don't know how it works, we can work with it. Even though we don't know why it works, we know how it works. Okay, so there's clues along the way. And so when we start to think, well, yeah, Western medicine or yeah, Western science, I mean, we run into the mystery. I talked to a scientist. I said, well, talk to me about the heart. He said, well, the heart is so mysterious. It doesn't operate with normal physics. It's like a match that learned how to light itself. Like, whoa. And then instead of it just burning down and having no more energy potential, it regrows itself and lights itself again. That's how mysterious your heart is. And it's like, oh, remember, you're mysterious. Nobody has all the answers to you. So we got to work with the mystery. We got to work with that. That's why these ancient practices that really help to dive into the mystery and work with it on a really functional well. So Qigong is an art and a science. And so when we start to work with Qi, your heart Qi, your digestive Qi, your nervous system Qi, there's all these different kinds of Qi in your body, emotional Qi, we start to work with it skillfully. That skillful living is what Qigong really helps us to achieve.
So essentially, we're all Jedi masters, sir. Focusing.
We really are.
Really just controlling the force. We just can't move anything just yet with our minds.
Just yet. That's right. Come to class for a few weeks, though. Now, you know, that's a great point because this pop culture is really talking about Qi a lot. You know, the force, You know, we look at Harry Potter. I mean, we're fascinated. Doctor Strange. These are all examples of Qigong practice. I was watching with one of my kids, Kung Fu Panda. Kung Fu Panda became the master of Qi. I was like, yes, he's talking about it very directly. So it's really in our pop culture, and we don't even know what our potential is. And Qigong is really something that unlocks your potential.
So you were mentioning that this is an ancient practice, about 4,000 years old. What do we know about the origins of this, and how did it hold itself over centuries where many things get lost along the way? Yoga practices being one of them. I mean, yoga came and went, and it kind of like got lost and then got found again. I'd love to hear a little bit about the history of, if as much as you might know, of the ancient origins of Qigong.
Mm-hmm. You know, the origins of Qigong practice are shamanistic. And so what did the shamans do? You know, 10,000 years ago, somebody was sick. They were talking about spirits invading the body, these invisible energies, right? And, you know, whether it was a virus or bacteria or emotions, they talked about these forces, these energies. Now, you know, one day I feel good, the next day I don't feel good. And so they started to see, well, what are we going to do about it? Well, they would maybe dance, they would drum, they would invoke different forces to help the energy move. So whether they were moving their bodies, chanting, singing, all of a sudden, what they started to find was different movements, sounds, started moving energy in different ways. Now, instead of just keeping it as a shamanistic practice, they started to systematize it, make it more repeatable, verifiable. And over time, what happened, these movements started to arise. Like if I move my body and breathe this way, it was good for my lungs and it could clear asthma. If I move my body in this way, it was good for my back pain. If I moved in this way, it helped my digestion. And so over time, and being very sensitive people to energy, they started to develop certain movements and points, like acupressure points on the body, and really verifying that, oh, this helped. Oh, if I push this point, it was like a light switch that turned on the light bulb in my head. You know, so acupressure, Qigong, breathing exercises, meditations, they all started to become systematized over time because thousands and thousands of people started trying it. And remember, this is a culture that was, you know, there were no cell phones, no TV. You're sitting out in nature and you have thousands of hours just to be with yourself and figure out what your energy system was doing. Like, what happens if I do this? You just had hours on your hands. So these were pioneers. These are pioneers that were pioneering the mind-body connection. And that's really what we're talking about.
Now, being a Qigong master and understanding a deep level of understanding energy, do you have a sensibility when you meet people to pick up on their different energy traits? Because I've always said to people, like, hey, have you ever, you know, wanted to take a shower after dealing with a car salesman? Because you feel mm-hmm. dirty afterwards, or someone tried to pick you up at a bar and you felt dirty, or you meet someone and you're like, my God, they feel so toxic. Is doing Qigong allow you to become a little bit more sensitive to that kind of stuff?
Yeah. And much more sensitive. And it gives you the ability to like energetically clear really quickly after talking with those people. You know, I was just describing it the other day. It's like, you know, you go out into life and there's people with toxic energy. It's like going to a buffet. There's you know, donuts and McDonald's on the table. Doesn't mean you have to eat it, right? So even though you're around it, you're not taking it in. Now, too many of us, we're just so affected by everything around us. That's whether we look at a news article, talk to this person, talk to a car salesman, my boss. You know, maybe one of your kids is in a really grumpy mood. Now you deal with them and now you're in a grumpy mood. We don't necessarily have to take on somebody's energy. That's a really great skill to have. You know, I have teenagers and, you know, I have twin teenagers. Oh. And they were, you know, they wanted to do something. I said no. They were cranky about it. And I just was like, I was able to just stay in my center and not take on their energy. I'm like, hey, I'm really sorry you feel that way. But the answer is no. How we're doing, guys? Yeah, sorry, Dad. Everything's fine. And hey, guys, let's go on a bike ride. Okay. It was just like, because I could stay in my center, I didn't I didn't add stress to the circumstance.
Right.
You know what I mean? So like, and when you're out in the world around you, notice when you're around people who makes you feel good, who brings you up, what circumstance, who makes you feel a little bit lower, like, oh man, I feel tighter or I feel toxic. And how do we get rid of that energy really quickly? And that's a really good skill that Qigong helps us with.
Now, I'm going to ask you a couple of questions, ask all my guests. What is your mission in this life?
To help spread ancient healing practices and make them relevant for modern times.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
To recognize our power and potential, to live joyfully, to live in our heart space with love and compassion.
And where can people find out more about you and your work and things like that?
Come to HoldenQigong.com. And Qigong is spelled Qigong. Holden, H-O-L-D-E-N, Qigong.com. HoldenQigong.com. And we got all kinds of free stuff and condition-specific things, like I said. So I look forward to having people come over there.
And I have to ask this one question. Why is it sometimes C-H-I and sometimes it's Q-I? You know, like what is the difference?
As if it's not confusing enough. You know, there's two different translations of Chinese into Roman characterization. So the C-H-I came from Harvard. Harvard said, oh, we're going to, you know, back in the 60s or something, we're going to make it more phonetic. But the Q-I is the pinyin that comes from China. They said, this is how you Roman character our language. So there's two different systems that float out there. But they, you know, Qigong is spelled Qigong or Chikung, but they both mean the same thing.
Lee, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you, man. I feel more energetic and understanding more about energy and breath, and hopefully this episode will help some people deal with stress a little bit better and dive into Qigong and spread the word. So I appreciate all the hard work you do, my friend. Thank you so much.
Oh, thanks so much, Alex. It was great to meet you. Great to be on your show. You're doing great work.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey. And don't forget to subscribe.